No, I'm sorry, this is not the i5-4460 versus i3-6100 review. That's coming very soon. I know I keep saying that, but it is coming very soon. In the meantime, hey everyone, Greg here with Science Studio, and what we will do in the meantime is we're going to compare the new Intel i3-6100 to the AMD FX-6300. So I understand that the FX series is very popular. It was very popular when it first came out, and it still is to this day just because it's cheap and it's powerful. But how powerful is it? And is it more powerful than Intel's newest i3 two-core four-thread processors? So I know right out of the gate you're probably thinking, well, the FX-6300 has six cores. It's a hexa-core processor. It has a lot more processing power, right? I mean, even if the CPU frequencies don't match, six cores is always better than four cores, right? Or two cores and four threads, right? So the tests we're going to run fall into two different categories. The first three tests that we have are going to be CPU independent. So that means that the GPU really won't be doing anything at all. It will just stress the CPU itself. And the three tests that we've chosen are, one, the Cinebench CPU test. So we'll be using Cinebench R15 just to do raw CPU performance tests. The Geekbench 3 software, so we'll just be doing the cheap 32-bit, well, it's not even cheap, it's free, the free 32-bit Geekbench 3 test, so we'll be able to test the single-core performance and the multi-core performance of each processor. And then we've also kind of put together a little Adobe Premiere rendering test. So I have a one-minute video file, and I rendered it through both machines, and just recorded the times that it took to render the same file in both. And then we chose three games. We chose Dying Light, Grand Theft Auto 5, and Dota 2. In those cases, highest FPS wins. Simple as that. And you'll see why we chose those three games here in a second. So the test benches for both of these CPUs are going to be completely different. There's just nothing we can do about it. One uses DDR3, one uses DDR4. One uses an AM3 Plus socket, and one uses an LGA 1151 socket. So there's no way to compare them equally. I mean, that's what you get for comparing a 4-year-old processor with a 1-year-old processor. That's just what you have to deal with. But for the AMD processor, our test bench consists of the following. We used an ASUS M5A97 Revised 2.0 motherboard. So this is an AM3 Plus socket motherboard. And we also threw in two 4GB sticks of DDR3 clocked at 1600 megahertz, which is kind of the run-of-the-mill DDR3 frequency. So nothing really outlandish there. And the other thing to note is that we did overclock the CPU to 4GHz. Now, before you freak out, we also overclocked the i3 to 4GHz as well. And if you're wondering how on earth I overclocked an i3, check out this video here, and I will show you how to do that. Not really difficult at all, if you have a Z170 motherboard. But okay, anyway, on the Intel side of things, I will be using my personal rig, this one right here. So this has an ASRock Z170 Pro 4 LGA 1151 motherboard in it. And we also have two 4GB sticks as well, but this time of DDR4. And these are clocked, I'm gonna make sure I get this right. These are clocked at 2346 megahertz for a total of 8GB, also in dual channel. Now, if you're wondering why the RAM frequency is a bit funky, well, it has to do with the fact that I overclocked using the base clock method. So when I turn up my base clock, I'm not only increasing my CPU frequency, but I'm also increasing my RAM frequency. So my DIMMs were raised as a result from a base of 21.33 times 100, which is 2133. To 21.33 times 110, which gave me a value of 2346. So if you're wondering why that's why. I know the RAM speeds aren't gonna match regardless, but hey, that's an incentive for going with a newer platform. You get DDR4, and you get higher clock speeds naturally, so that's just part of the recipe in this case. Oh, and I should mention, we are using identical R9380 graphics cards. They are clocked exactly the same. One's a Sapphire and one's a Gigabyte, but they're exactly the same. They even use the exact same PCB. So that we've made sure has remained constant in both platforms. Now that the platforms are out of the way and you know what we're running in both scenarios, let's get straight into the benchmarks, which I know you've been waiting for. So which one really is better, the i3-6100 or the FX-6300? First benchmark test on the list is the Cinebench benchmark. And, well, the scores were, they were expected. The i3's two cores and four threads really underperformed compared to the FX-6300's hexa-core architecture. So the i3 scored a 435 and the FX scored a 453. Now, I know this graph looks a little strange to you. It looks like the FX just blew the i3 out of the water. But if you look at the bottom, the x-axis there, you'll see that everything's been scaled to within like 50 points or so. So we also made an adjusted score graph, and this one kind of puts things into perspective a little better. So you can see that really the i3 didn't do that much worse than the FX processor. I mean, they were relatively close. I think the i3 only scored 18 points under the FX. So for only being a two-core four-thread processor, it did well to keep up with the FX 6300. So if you're wondering how Cinebench works, whenever you click the run button, you'll see a series of yellow squares start to kind of form a spiral shape out from the center. And the number of yellow squares is determined by how many threads your CPU runs on. So if your processor has four threads, you can only have four yellow squares running at any time to render that image. So in the case of the FX 6300, six yellow squares could be rendered at any given time, whereas for our i3, even though it has hyper-threading, it still only has four threads, so it was only able to render four yellow squares at a time. So just a quick little run through of how Cinebench works. But anyway, let's move on to Geekbench. Geekbench 3 is up next, and these outcomes, they were a bit different. So the i3 scored a single core score of 4,098. This is actually like the third or fourth, I can't remember. I think it's the third highest score of any CPU that's ever been tested on Geekbench. And that's just because of the new architecture, the new Skylake architecture. The 14 nanometer technology just kind of takes the cake here. You can see that the i3 did perform much better in single core. Now, multi-core, a lot of things step all over the i3, but for single core performance, that really is not bad for how much you're paying for the processor. And of course, it did only score an 8724 multi, but that's actually better than the FX's multi-score of 8447. And you can also see that the FX's single core performance was not too shabby at all. It actually is about half as efficient by these standards as the i3. So yeah, so even though the FX 6300 does have two more cores and hence two more threads, the i3 is still better as a multi-core processor, at least in this test. I'm not trying to step on your toes, but in this particular test, the i3 wins. So let's move on from that. I don't want to keep you on that one for too much longer. The Adobe Premiere Pro test. So what I did was I took a 1 minute video file. It was just a movie clip, something I filmed, and I trimmed it down to just 1 minute. I couldn't get it exactly at 1 minute, but it was like 1 minute and 0.03 seconds or something like that. And I rendered that video clip on both platforms. I made sure nothing else was running. I made sure to use the exact same preset for both, and these were the times. So the i3 was able to render the video file in 1 minute and 22.73 seconds. Very impressive, actually. So for a 10 minute file, it's only gonna take about 15 minutes to render. It's not bad at all. Now remember here, the shorter the bar, the better. So you want a lower score in this case. The FX, it only scored 2 minutes and 3 seconds. Well, I shouldn't say only, I mean, it scored more. It scored 2 minutes and 3.01 seconds. It took a bit longer, a whole 40 seconds almost. So I don't know what conclusions you can make from that particularly, but what it tells me is that the i3 utilizes its four threads more efficiently than the FX processor does. So that's basically what I concluded from it, but of course, you're free to make your own conclusions. I'm just showing you the graphs because this stuff took a while to come up with. So let's move on from that and let's get into the stuff that I know you actually do care about, and that is the gaming performance. How well does each platform run the three games that we've chosen? So the first up was Dying Light, nice zombie game, kind of like GTA in a way. I mean, it's an open world, so you can kind of just do whatever you want unless you want to do the missions. And I made sure that in both cases, I ran through the exact same places. I just used fraps to record the minimum, average, and highest FPS rate, and there you go. Now keep in mind that these are both running identical R9 380s. And we noticed from the first batch of results that Dying Light really is not a CPU intensive game, like at all. Our scores were very consistent, so I guess you could say that, well, it could mean one of two things. Either the CPUs are identical and the GPUs are identical, or the game just doesn't really care much about the CPU performance and is solely a graphics card performer. And so you will see in a second that it is only a graphics card performer because things change when we hop into GTA 5. Now, you probably know by now, just because of the fact that I've said it probably 100 times on other videos, that Grand Theft Auto V is a very CPU intensive game. This is where we should start to see one processor pull ahead of the other. One did. But is it the one that you expected? The Intel i3 was the clear winner in this case. It achieved an average FPS nearly 10 frames above the FX 6300 and was able to reach much higher max frame rates as well. We made sure that VSync was off and we kept all the settings exactly the same in both cases. Now, gameplay was smooth for both, don't get me wrong. I mean, 40 FPS looks pretty similar to 50 FPS, but that's a 10 FPS difference, and that means a lot to a lot of people. So that's what we wanted to show you in this particular scenario, that you can edge out an extra 10 to 15 FPS in GTA 5 if you choose to forego the FX6300 and opt for the newer Intel i3-6100. So last on our list is Dota 2, and if you're not a GTA 5 or Dying Light gamer, chances are you're probably a Dota 2 gamer, so that's why we chose this one. But wow, was Dota 2 super hungry for graphics? I mean, it craved processing cores. It was heating up my GPU more than Grand Theft Auto 5. I did not expect it at all, but it just confirmed the fact that we made a good decision in choosing Dota 2. So we maxed everything out. We made sure that we were running in full 1080p on both platforms, and it seems like Dota 2 doesn't really rely on either the CPU or the GPU, but prefers like a mix, like a co-op. I don't know, something like that, co-op. But the Intel side of things did edge out a slight lead in this case, all around, from the average FPS to the max to the minimum. There was about a 5 to 10 FPS difference. So I think in this case, if you are a Dota 2 player or like a World of Warcraft gamer or something like that, you're probably not going to have a problem just forgoing the i3 and choosing the FX6300. So you're not going to see enough of an increase, in my opinion, to spend the extra money on the i3. So that's what I want you to get out of this. You've seen all of the results and you've probably concluded that the i3 is a bit better in games and in just raw CPU performance. But does that justify the extra price? Well, I would say that roughly 6 months ago, it wouldn't have justified the price, because the DDR4 and LGA 1151 platform was still super expensive. I mean, to get DDR4, you'd have to drop at least $100 on like an 8 gig kit. Now you can get DDR4 for roughly the same price as DDR3. Prices for socket LGA 1151 have come down significantly over the past year, and that's why I believe that choosing the i3-6100 over the FX6300 is a wise choice. Look, you can build on both platforms for roughly the same price. This one that I built behind me cost $650 in parts, but the FX build that I built before that one cost about the same. It was like $620, and I got the exact same graphics card. So it's not much more that I can tell you. I believe that i3 is the way to go. Yeah, you're gonna have less cores, but if those 6 cores in the FX processor aren't going to run as efficiently, then there's no point in even purchasing a 6-core processor, right? So, I don't know. If you're an AMD fanboy, and I mean no disrespect by that because I was at one point as well, wait till Zen comes out. See how Zen treats you. But if you're very desperate to build a gaming PC on a budget right now, I would go i3. I think it's a no-brainer. Thanks for watching, everyone. If you like the benchmarks, if you like the stuff that we showed you in this video, be sure to give us a thumbs up. But if you hated the video outright and just thought it was straight crap, give us a thumbs down, let us know in the comments below what you'd like to see next and what you'd like to see improved in future videos. Be sure to subscribe for more, there will be more because we said so. This is Science Studio, thanks for learning with us. Oh, and choose wisely.